Good morning, everybody. It's great to see you, and I want to welcome you, especially if you're visiting us for the very first time. We continue through our preaching series through Paul's second letter to the church in Corinth. Now, we're going to encounter an interesting metaphor, a picture in the second letter, and it reminds me also what we were just singing, you are worthy of it all. And so the question begs this morning, is Jesus worthy of your adoration? Not just your worship through singing and emotions, but is Jesus worthy of denying yourself, taking up your cross, following Him? Is He worthy of everything? Is He worthy of laying down your lives completely for Him? And can you connect the words that we were just singing with a scripture? And I trust this morning that there will be some connection, and you will make some connection and be confronted with a question that Jesus is worthy of it all, of our lives, of our adoration, not just our singing, but our lives and laying down our lives. And that from Him are all things, and that He works in all things. Now, in the ancient times, you would find clay pots. Not exactly like this, but maybe similar. And in ancient times and in the first century, and as Paul writes to the church in Corinth, those people would have clearly understood the metaphor, the picture that Paul is using. And clay pots was used to transport or keep things like wine and oil and food and some kind of treasures that people would have, and to keep it safe in there. And then Paul reminds the church there that we are like clay pots. And then we go right back to Genesis 2 and 3, and we are reminded that from the dust of the ground we've been created. And that we go back to the dust of the ground. And so we are confronted with reality. We're confronted with our own death. And it's in the confrontation of our own death that we stand in amazement of the majesty and the glory of God and of His power. And so we're confronted with our own frailty. But Paul says, just these clay pots, it says, and if I would take that clay pot and I would have a light in there, you wouldn't be able to see this light. Paul says, we are not just clay pots, but we are actually indeed cracked clay pots. Very kind of frail clay pots. If you switch off the light, are you able to see the light now? But from this side, can you see the light? You can't see the light. But you see the light shining through the cracks. And Paul says, we are like these clay pots, our physical body. You know, we have the good, the bad, and the ugly of life. And we have the hammer of life. We have afflictions. We have persecutions. We have things happening around us. We have the attack of the devil and his demons. We live in a fallen, broken, messed up world. And life happens, and it's like a hammer blow into this physical body as well. And there are cracks in our bodies. We are frail. We are people that can easily break. Not just our hearts that can break, but our bodies are subjected to brokenness. Just again being reminded of that as I met someone again earlier this morning. I can remember 20 years ago when I saw this individual. This person was not in a wheelchair. 20 years plus later, this person is in a wheelchair. Things happen. We are, as Paul says, we are these broken pots. We are these cracked clay pots. We are not exempt. The broken pieces of our lives might be lying around everywhere, we see that. But again, we come to appreciate and experience how powerful God is when we encounter death, when we encounter our own weakness, our own frailty. And so this morning we want to read from 2 Corinthians chapter 4. And I want to encourage you to read through Paul's letter, his second letter to the church in Corinth, again and again, a couple of times. We're not necessarily going through everything, but we're in chapter 4. And I want to read from verse 7 to verse 12. From verse 7 to verse 12. And I'm reading from the English Standard Version. But we have this treasure in jars of clay. Paul is saying again, he says, your life and my life is like a jar of clay. He's using this metaphor of a clay pot and is saying, this is you and me. We are not just beautiful clay pots. We are in fact cracked, broken clay pots. And we keep on being cracked and we keep on being broken, but there's something in this. There's a treasure to be found in that clay pot. But we have this treasure in jars of clay too. Either you find the word so that, which is a purpose statement, it's giving you a purpose, that's the reason, or you'd find the small little word too. It's a similar thing. Here's the purpose. Well, what is this purpose of this treasure in the jar of clay? It is to show that the surpassing power, brothers and sisters, not just any power, but the power that's above any powers, the power, the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. We are afflicted in every way, but we are not crushed. We are perplexed, but we are not driven to despair. We are persecuted, but not forsaken. Struck down, but not destroyed. Always carrying in our body, always carrying in this clay pot, the body, the death of Jesus, so that, the purpose, so that the life of Jesus may be also be manifested in our bodies. For we who live are always being given over to death, for Jesus' sake, so that the life of Jesus, that surpassing power, the life of Jesus, may also be manifested in our mortal flesh, in our clay pots. So death is at work in us, but life in you. I want to persuade you from this text this morning that my weakness becomes an opportunity for the power of God to be displayed. I want to encourage you that my weakness and your weakness becomes an opportunity for God's power to be revealed, for God's power to be displayed. You see, it's not my strength becomes an opportunity for God's strength to be displayed, but it's your weakness and it's my weakness becomes an opportunity. I would maybe call them these grace moments, these grace opportunities, these seasons of grace. Because Paul was, I trust, not just referring to one moment or one opportunity, but to many seasons in his life. He says there are seasons of grace. God works all things. From him are all things. In him, all things hold together. And he says, these are moments of grace where my weakness becomes an opportunity for God's power to be revealed. And so Paul uses this metaphor of clay pots to put some depth to that declaration in verse 7. But we have this treasure in jars of clay to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. And so from our text this morning, I want to highlight 3 points to support this statement that my weakness and your weakness becomes an opportunity for God's power to be revealed. So number one, there's a pronouncement of power. There's a declaration of power. There's a pronouncement of power. And so when Paul pronounces, he declares this power, let us not be confused. whose power it is that he is pronouncing. Let us not be confused what the situation and the circumstances and the condition be for the pronouncement of this power, this surpassing power. Well, Paul says we have this treasure. What treasure is he speaking about? And so you need to read before verse 7 to find out what is the treasure he is speaking about. So let's read verse 6. For God who said, let light shine out of darkness. Where's that going to take you to? In the beginning, God. Most powerful words. That's where we start. That's where we start with all of creation. That's where we start with the universe. That's where we start with everything. That's where we start. That's where you and I start. It's not where we end, but this is where we start. In the beginning, God. In the beginning, God created. In the beginning, God said, let light shine into the darkness. And the same with you and me. This God, the sovereign creator God, who by the power of his words spoke light into darkness, is the same powerful God who spoke light, salvation light, into your darkness and your spiritual dead body. Your spirit that's dead, that doesn't want Jesus, that's disobedient, that's a rebel, that goes against Jesus. It's his work, it's his power that brought you and me to salvation so that you can stand up and say that Jesus is my Lord and Savior, so that I can declare in public before everybody standing in front of me and in the spiritual realm, I can be baptized as a sign that I follow Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior. And so this God, you and I get to call Father, Abba Father. This God we get to call Messiah, Savior, the Christ, the promised one, the anointed one, the one who saved me, the one who's working in me, the one who's living in me. When 1 John 4 verse 4 says, greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. He's speaking about this God who in the beginning said, light, let light shine into the darkness, has shone in our hearts. The same God. Not you and me, not our light bulb moments. The power of him, this surpassing power that said, let light shine under darkness, has shone in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. So what is this treasure? It says this treasure that you have in this clay pot, this light that is inside there, this light that is shining through there, that this surpassing power is the revelation power, the salvation power, the creation power of God himself that's in us, that's shining through. It says, and God has revealed him in the person of Jesus Christ. It says, when you look into the face of Christ, you see the glory, the majesty, the grace, the love, the mercy of God himself. It says, this is the treasure that you have in you. If you're sitting here and you're following Jesus Christ, the treasure that's in you is God himself that's in you. He's our treasure. Jesus is in us. He's the treasure. And he made his light shine into our darkness. And his light is shining through. It's the glory of Jesus, the power of Jesus that's in us. That's shining through. It says, that's the treasure that's in you. And then now, what's the purpose for this treasure? Now it says, now this is the pronouncement of this power. It says the purpose is very clear. As Christ followers, you and I are clay pots. We are maybe not even cracked clay pots, but we are broken clay pots. You just need to live long enough. For some of you, you might have a small little hairline crack in your clay pot. If Jesus doesn't return in the next 2 decades, you might be a broken clay pot. Even crushed to just a couple of pieces. And now the world tells us, let's just put everything together. Pick up the pieces. We just want to close everything. Where actually God says, oh, I'm going to shine through the cracks. I'm going to shine through your brokenness. Yes, life's going to happen, man. Life's going to happen. And we're trying to run away from the hammer of life, where God says, don't worry, bring on the hammer of life, so that, and there's the purpose in verse 7, to show that the surpassing power that's in you and me belongs to God, and it's not from me. It's not me, it's not my strength, it's not my wisdom, it's not my wit. It's not my psychology degree, it's not my theology degree, it's not my doctor's degree, it's not my education, it's not my ancestors, it's not my DNA that's in me. All those things are good, they're not bad, but it's not that. Because the purpose is God's power, to show that the surpassing power belongs to God and not to us. You see, friends, Paul is not comparing his weakness to God's power. Don't misunderstand Paul. Paul is saying, Christ follower, you will never be powerful in yourself. Whoa, that doesn't sound very good. That doesn't sound very convincing. That doesn't sound very uplifting. Let me zoom out. No, let's zoom into the Word of God. Let us come to surrender of Holy Spirit and let His Word get into our hearts. Paul is saying, you will never be powerful in yourself. You can say it 10 times over. You can say it 100 times over. You can think it's mind over matter. You can follow psychology. You see, these things infiltrated the world. It infiltrated the church, rather, things and the way that the world is thinking infiltrated the church. And we are so mixed, and we take the Word of God out of context. But Paul is saying clearly to you and me, you know, we will not be powerful in ourselves. No, we remain clay pots through which God's power is displayed. Clay pots through which God's power is displayed. You see, our weakness and our imperfection creates the perfect setting for God's power. Because otherwise, if it was like 90% God's power and 10% your and my power, I can still boast in my power. I can still stand on my power. The same with salvation. You see, it's not the cross of Jesus plus something else. It's not your self-righteousness. It's not your holiness. It's not your money. It's not your church attendance. It's not your father, your grandmother, whoever. Salvation is all of Jesus. It is His work. He is doing the thing. We've got nothing to contribute to bring to that. And now it says it's not just a little bit of God's power or a lot of God's power, and I need to kind of just add that 1% to make it complete. It's all of God's power. It says we will remain broken clay pots, weak vessels, and our imperfection is that beautiful setting for God's power to be displayed. Later on in this letter, Paul declares the following in chapter 12, verse 9. But he said to me, God says to him, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, because God's power is made perfect in weakness, he says, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Paul says, I'm content with weakness, insults, hardship, persecution, calamities, for when I'm weak, I'm strong. It doesn't mean when I'm weak, okay, then there's power in me, I'm going to stand up. He says, no, it's again God's power. Paul says, I'm growing in weakness, I'm embracing weakness. The more I embrace my weakness, the more God's power shines through. His creation, powerful resurrection power. So Paul makes it clear here, friends, that our weakness is not just incidental. It's not just by coincidence, not just accident. Paul makes it clear that your weakness and my weakness is not incidental, but essential for the power of God to be displayed in and through me. My weakness is essential for God's power to be displayed. So it's easy to misunderstand what Paul is saying. And we think the more I embrace my weakness, somehow it will enhance my power. I just need to acknowledge and embrace my weakness, and then it will enhance my power. As if the following equation is true. God's power plus my weakness equals my power. God's power plus our weakness equals our power. That's not what Paul is saying. If that is what you are thinking, then draw a red line through it, because that is not what Paul is saying. He says, no, God's power fills us. God's power is manifested through us. We are cracked clay pots. We are broken clay pots. We don't become powerful. No, friends. We remain weak. We don't grow in power. We grow in the display of God's power in us. We remain weak. We don't grow in our own power. There's a growth of the display and the manifestation of God's power through you and me. And the more that this clay pot is broken and crushed, the more God's power shines through. He is worthy of it all. Well, is he still worthy if you are cracked and broken? Is he still worthy when you might find yourself in a wheelchair? Is he still worthy if you find yourself jobless for the past year? Is he still worthy because he did not heal the way you want him and expect him to heal? Is he still worthy of these things when you suffer and going through heartache and pain and trouble? And is he still worthy? Because when there's a little crack in there, a little hairline crack, you might not see a lot of light. But when the spot is broken, there's way more light that's shining through. Way more power that's shining through. We don't become more powerful. We remain weak. We don't grow in power. We grow in weakness. Brothers and sisters, we grow from weakness to weakness. From cracked pots to broken pots. And so here's the biblical equation that Paul is saying. Paul is saying, my weakness plus God's power equals God's power. My weakness plus God's power equals God's power. We remain vessels of His power. We remain vessels of His power. And it's very humbling to realize that once I acknowledge my weakness, and my weakness doesn't make me strong, but acknowledging my weakness and embracing more weakness leads to more weakness. It's very humbling. St. Francis from Assisi, this guy was used by God powerfully in the kingdom of God, and someone once asked him the following and said, Francis, how did you accomplish so much for God? And he replied, this may be why the Lord looked down from heaven and said, where can I find the weakest, littlest man on earth? Then he said to me, ha, I found him, and he won't be proud of it. He'll see that I'm only using him because of his insignificance. But the world looks around and says, we need to find the person of significance. We scan through the CVs. We're looking for the most qualified person. We want to choose the best candidate. And sometimes even the church operates that way. But God says, I'm looking for the most insignificant person. Jesse, line up your sons. Oh, surely it must be this guy that God is choosing. Do you have any more sons? He's so insignificant, I actually forgot about him. he's looking after the sheep. You know, kind of, that's what he's doing. Okay, call him. David? God is looking at the most insignificant, seemingly small person. But somehow it has infiltrated our church. We want to impress people with performances, with styles. People follow people more than they follow Jesus. We're following the celebrity pastors. the celebrity pastors and girls. We follow the Barbie dolls, the ones that's got the most influence on social media, the most likes. Tall, dark, handsome, big muscles, nice tattoos. Maybe that's why God made me small, thin. I can list you all my physical imperfections. I don't line up with any of them. Forget my physical imperfections. You haven't seen my heart. You haven't seen the sin and the stuff that I battle in my heart. You haven't seen the stuff that I battle with and just think I'm not worthy. I'm not worthy. I need to fight that thing daily. I just need to look on Facebook. I just need to get into the room with a whole lot of other pastors. I hear them preaching, hear them speaking. Look at them. Look at that. And then all of a sudden I'll be reminded of my own insignificance. But then I have to lead my heart that it's His surpassing power that's in me. That I'm not here because I'm the best qualified person. I'm just here because I just step out of faith and say, I just want to be obedient to you, God. And I had to learn that it's Him working in me. Oh, trust you, me. In the beginning, there was a thing that I really thought, it's all about me. I'm significant. You grow in weakness and realize that it's God working in you. But we have this treasure in a jar of clay so that the surpassing power belongs to God. And so I want to ask you a question. Have you embraced weakness as a way of life? Have you embraced weakness as a way of life? Because when I study the life of Jesus, it seems to me that's pretty much what He did. Being obedient to the Father, relying on the Father. Because you see, when I embrace weakness in my life, it's actually an invitation for Jesus to come. You see, Jesus is not going to work through the man and the woman that's self-righteous and think they've got everything together. Jesus, I've got it 50%. Jesus, I've got it 80% sorted out. Please, I need 100%. Could you just fill up? Can you just give me another 20? Or Jesus, I've got 10%. Could you just give me 90%? Jesus probably say, no, I don't respond to that kind of an invitation. Jesus responds to an invitation when we have nothing. When we are empty. When we are broken clay pots. Jesus says, whoa, I can work with this. Because all of a sudden, he or she is very insignificant. I can work with this. Where do you find yourself? Let the Holy Spirit speak to you. So we find this, the pronouncement of power, of His power. The second thing we find here in verse 8 and 9 are the paradoxes of power. It's these contradictions, these seemingly contradictions. Have you ever heard, or maybe you've used the phrase, okay, there's peace in the storm. Have you experienced peace in the storm? It's a contradiction, because when you're in a storm, you're not supposed to experience peace. What are you supposed to experience? Fear. That's how God's kingdom works. It's an upside-down kingdom. It's a paradox. It's in the middle of, you should, people look at you and they say to you, you should fall apart. Because when I look at your life, everything is going pear-shaped. Everything is going down. Why are you so calm? Why do you have it all together? Tell me, what's your secret? Give me the book. The seven secrets to success. The seven secrets to being keeping powerful. The seven secrets to keep your head. The seven secrets to stay above the storm. Keep your head above the waves. Tell me what it is. I want the formula. I want the quick formula, because we live in a microwave society. Oh, you should watch this sermon. No, follow this guy. No, do this. What is your secret? My secret is I embrace my weakness. And my weakness leads to more weakness. Because then His surpassing power, His resurrection power is going to shine through me. Because it's about His glory and honor. These paradoxes. So Paul mentioned here, you know, four seemingly hopeless situations. Maybe it was seasons in his life. He mentions four things, and then he mentions four buts. Not like a butt in your backside butt, but it's like a Bible butt. You know, those beautiful butts. You see these things happening, and it's terrible, and then but God. It's a hopeless situation. We come in front of the Red Sea. There's no way through. But God made a way through. Whatever happened to you, whatever it is, whatever is the most terrible situation, but God. But God might not change that situation, but God's going to take you through it. He's going to take you through the fire and through the storm. Don't you like the buts that we find in the Bible? And then Paul says, here are these four things. And then Paul mentions them. And it says, we were afflicted in every way, but not crushed. Maybe you can identify with some of these things. Affliction. In this letter, Paul mentions these things. I'm afflicted, but not crushed. I'm perplexed, but perplexed, bewildered, but I'm not driven to despair. I'm afflicted, or not despaired. Maybe we can just say, I'm squeezed, but I'm not squashed. And now everything has been squeezed out of me, but I'm not like squashed. Perplexed, but not driven to despair. We are persecuted, but we are not forsaken. 2 Corinthians 1, Paul says this beautiful part in verse 8 to 10. Paul says, we are persecuted, but we are not forsaken. Why not? Because he says, God has delivered us, and He will deliver us again. On Him we have set our hope, that He will deliver us again. We are perplexed, but we are not despair. It's this idea of being lost, of I don't know where to go. I just lost the signal. Have you ever been in that situation? You're driving on a GPS. And then it's like, man, I need to turn. What do I need to do? There are a lot of options in front of me. Where's the signal? Ask my wife. I get frustrated. I get annoyed. I get scared. Finding ourselves in another country, and this thing is not working. I need to turn. There's a turn off. Do I need to stay on the highway? Do I need to go off? Well, what do I need to do? This thing is not responding. I'm perplexed. But I'm not in despair. Paul says, yes, in chapter 1, he had delivered us. He will deliver us again. And He will definitely deliver us in the future. We are persecuted, but we're not forsaken. The same thing. We are not forsaken. God is with us. He will lead us through this. The fourth thing is, now we find almost that these difficulties, these fourfold difficulties is building up. And then the fourth thing is like, man, this is the big thing. This is the big thing. We are struck down, but we are not forsaken. We are knocked down, but we are not knocked out. Hashtag, hulle weet wat ons weet. That means, hashtag, they don't know what we know. So this thing started by Driekus du Plessis, who's this MMA fighter. And then when he wins this battle, he's saying and speaking to the South Africans when he's overseas, they don't know what we know as South Africans. Hulle weet wat ons weet. Now you're saying the same thing. You're saying to the world, you're saying to the devil and his demons, you're saying to them, you don't know what we know. I said, what is it? What is it? The more I embrace my weakness, the weaker I become, and the more His glory and power shines through me. You know, you don't know what? It looks as if I'm knocked down. Some of you might be knocked down, but you know you will never be knocked out. because God's power is with you. You might be persecuted, but I'm not forsaken. I'm perplexed, but I'm not in despair. I'm squeezed, but I'm not squashed. Can you just listen to that again as this build up? Squeezed, bewildered, pursued, knocked down. That's horrible weakness. But I'm not squashed. I'm not in despair. I'm not abandoned. I'm not knocked out. What astonishing, surpassing power that comes from God that's leading me here. It's not a mind over matter thing. It is a supernatural working of God in my and your life. And so when I see and find myself insignificant, when I look at others and I look at myself, then I need to lead my own heart and remind me, Theo, that it's God's power working in me. Only God can take a little insignificant, almost familyless, almost landing up on the street, little scared, insignificant boy from the Free State, unable to speak properly. Only God can take someone like that and keep on working in his life. And it's not all of a sudden as if I've arrived, but I need to go back and back again. Sometimes I feel like I'm completely broken. There have been many times that I've been completely broken and I'm trying to work out my own strength. And then I need to realize again, surrender. Jesus, your power in me. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that I can remain a cracked clay pot so that your power can shine brightly through. Paul says, not me, but God, but God, but God. You see, I think we can reasonably conclude here in each of these four desperate situations in chapter 4 that Paul turned to God in every one of them. And he found power from God and from the people that actually prayed with him. Because in chapter 1, verse 8 to 10, he said, God has delivered us. He's now delivering us. He will deliver us again. You also must help us by prayer. So I think that is the deduction for me that Paul prayed in that situation and now saying, you must also help us with prayer. And we're going to pray for one another at the end of the service. Because some of you feel that, you know what, I'm really knocked down. And you need to know that you are not crushed. You're knocked down, but you're not knocked out. You're squeezed, but you're not crushed. And that you need to embrace that and allow the power of God to work through you. That we will stand around one another and we together pray out that God will bring his supernatural strength. And so we have the pronouncement of power, we have the paradoxes of power, and then we have the principle of power, verse 10 to 12, the principles of power. You see, the point here in verse 10 to 12 is that your and my experience mirror that of Jesus. What did we say last week? Deny yourself, take up your cross, follow Jesus. Sorry. It wasn't a nice retweet slogan. It was actually Jesus that said that. We don't find that often repeated, retweeted, re-exed. I don't know what you call it now. Let's keep tweet. Okay? For those of you who are on Twitter or X, want to share that. We don't walk into the Bible bookshop and look for that fridge magnet that says, deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow Jesus. We look for the Philippians 4:13 one. We look for the Jeremiah 29:11 one. We look for the John 10:10 one. And we all use it out of context. At least that's maybe what I think in my heart for myself. And we had to learn. But by God's grace, we had to grow in that. So no. The similar thing that's happening to Jesus is happening to you and me. And Jesus had a cross before a crown. Why do we want the crown before the cross? If we're going to follow Jesus, there's going to be a cross before there's going to be a crown. The similar thing happens to you and me. Jesus was crucified in weakness, and it was God's power that raised him. And the same with you and me. We experience the weakness and the suffering and the pain and the insults of Jesus. But it doesn't stop there. But we also experience the resurrection power of Jesus. Right now, it's working in us, but it will ultimately finally work in us when Jesus returns. 2 Corinthians 4, verse 14 to 17. So read this also, this whole part in context. And we cannot read 7 to 12 without reading this. And we find the resurrection power of Christ working in us now, but ultimately in the future. Verse 14, knowing that he who raised Jesus from the dead, Paul is just saying, he says, God's resurrection, creation, transformational power is working in me right now. Paul is saying, I'm going through tough things, guys. Chapter 6. He's saying we were going through all these things, great endurance in affliction, hardship, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labor, sleeplessness, hunger in chapter 6. Chapter 7, he says, when we went to Macedonia, okay, we were downcasted, okay? We were in tough times. We're experiencing more physical affliction from the outside. I was grieved, not just physical affliction, but his worries inside about the churches. And now he says in verse 14, knowing that he who raised the Lord Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us with you, Corinthians, into his presence. And so the resurrection power of Jesus is working in me now as I keep on being a cracked, broken clay pot. But one day when Jesus returns, his resurrection power will take this broken clay pot and he will completely transform it into a glorified, eternal body, a physical glorified body like his body. There's a very soft murmuring from all the older people. Aren't you excited? Aren't you excited? You young guys, you don't understand this, do you? You think you're invincible. When you're 18 years old, you're invincible. When you're 25, you're invincible. Until you become 45 and 55 and 65 and then the knees doesn't want to work anymore. For whatever reason. I hope we live in the expectation and the promise and the power of this verse. Yes, I've got his resurrection power right now. I experience this. But do we live in the light of this? Knowing that he who raised Jesus will raise us also with Jesus and bring us into his presence. And then he say, we do not lose heart. Why, Paul? Please tell me, why don't I lose heart? Though my outer self is wasting away. How can you say that? Paul, do you know what it means to try and get up? Sorry to put my wife on the spot. So on Thursday, Friday, they were putting tables in here. It was the Women's Day thing, and they were preparing everything. And so I walk into the auditorium, and here's my wife lying like a mechanic underneath the table. And she's just fixing paper and putting sellotape and everything there. And then she says, she asks someone, oh, I need to go to the next table. Please help me up. Okay, we get her up. But the 15-year-old girl that I met, I mean, she was dancing on the tables. No, she's lying on the ground and we need to get her up. And I was just reminded that she's wasting away. And then a couple of minutes later, I'm reminded that I'm wasting away and I'm saying, oh, Jackie, I don't know what's this pain in my groin. Because it's been going on, and is this gout in my toe? Because the past 2 weeks I'm struggling with this. What is this going on? We joke about it, but But friends, there are way more serious medical diagnoses that we're experiencing. The heartache that we're experiencing. You know, gout in a toe, that's a minor thing. There are other stuff that's very more serious. But whatever you are going through physically, I want you to know that the power that raised Jesus from the dead is going to bring life to your physical body. But so that we do not lose heart, though our outer self is wasting away, our inner self has been renewed day by day. For this light and momentary affliction, what do you mean, Paul? Light? Momentary affliction? It's been going on for maybe 10, 20 years. Do you call 20 years a moment? I've just highlighted to you chapter 6, chapter 7, the things that Paul is going through. Then those things that he went through physically, the worries in his heart about the church. He says, this is a moment for this light and momentary affliction is preparing for us. God is working. I wonder in whose hand the hammer is. Not for destruction. But so that we can learn to trust in Him alone. Because He's not going to share His glory with another. God's not interested in your power and my power. He's interested so that you will embrace your weakness so that His power will be manifested. He says, these afflictions, these momentary afflictions, they are preparing, they are working for us an eternal weight. You see, what you're going through right now feels like a weight. It feels like this massive anchor around your ankle and you're trying to swim. Have any one of you ever swam from Purley's to the island and what you got around your ankle is a 5 kg weight? Anyone ever done that? If you tried that, that will be stupid. Okay, get rid of the weight. But now he says, what we're going to be when Jesus returns. He says, in the moment we're going through the pain and the suffering and the heartache and the worries, And trying to just find myself and you know, battling myself with my own insignificance, apart from my physical struggles, apart from the worries for the church and churches, it says what you're going to get when Jesus returns, it's going to be a weight. It's going to anchor you. And so the promise of the future is to anchor us. That weight is to anchor you. Anchor not for destruction, but for hope. It says that weight of glory. When we look Jesus, and we will see Him as He is, and in an instant, you will be changed. In a moment, it says. At the return of Christ to this earth, to make a new earth and a new heaven. In the meantime, we're not looking to escape this earth. In the meantime, we're seeing how we can bring Him more glory and honor. How we can be more broken pots, more cracks, so that His power and His glory can shine through. The weight of glory beyond all comparison. Does that excite you? That there's a glory coming? That nothing on this earth can compare to what Jesus is going to give you and me? What we will be when we see Him face to face? You see, we need Holy Spirit and the written Word of God to help you and me when we face difficulties, to let that promise of the future sustain you and me and to carry us through. And see, my pain and my heartache and the diagnosis from the doctor and whatever I'm going through, that's not worth comparing of the glory that we will receive when Jesus returns and make all things new. As we look not to the things that are unseen, but to the not to the things that are seen, but to the things that are unseen. He's speaking about the second coming of Christ and making all things new. What a powerful part. So Paul, and then Paul says, just to end off in verse 12, it says, this power that he's experiencing from God is not for him to have a nice feeling, to post something on Facebook.
It says it's for service. It's for ministry. Not just for the pastor, but for every member. So that you can serve one another with the power that God gives you. Verse 12, so death is at work in us, but life in you. It's for ministry. It's for laying down our lives. How does the church needs the message of 2 Corinthians 4 today? Because we're living in a world of idols. We got the American idols and the South African idols. But in church, we find the idols as well. We worship. We are busy with idolatry. We're following human idols. You find church leaders, pastors. I'm generalizing now. That it's more about following, it's more about impression, it's more about people. And we idolize people. We put people on a pedestal. We worship people instead of Jesus. I haven't seen much pastors in a wheelchair and struggling and battling physically and emotionally on a stage and have a massive following. I would like to see a lot of celebrity leaders 30 years from today. I really pray that by God's power, we will keep on. It's not how you start this race, it's how you finish this race. In conclusion, it's both beautiful and liberating. It's beautiful and liberating to know that it's not my power, that it's God's power. It liberates me. Oh man, this releases me. I don't need to pull myself up by my bootstraps. I don't need to try harder. I just need to embrace my weakness. It's liberating for me. I don't have it. I learned that lesson regularly. It needs to liberate me. It is beautiful that it's not my power, but it's God's power in my life. And that the pursuit of power doesn't come from pursuing power. The pursuit of power comes from embracing weakness. Embracing weakness. So, not my strength, not my greatness, His power. My weakness becomes an opportunity for God's power to be revealed, displayed. Let us pray together. Lord Jesus, we confess that to You alone belongs the surpassing power. You alone promise us, give us this, the surpassing hope and this promise that our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us. They are working for us. It's not the troubles itself, but it's You that are working in and through these momentary afflictions. You are working in these moments and these afflictions to bring forth an eternal weight of glory that will outshine everything else. But in the meantime, we struggle. But help us to struggle by surrendering. Help us that the pathway to greatness is not actually up the ladder, but down the ladder. The pathway to greatness is actually walking towards the cross and kneel in the dust in front of the cross, denying ourselves, taking up our cross daily and following You, embracing our weakness so that Your strength can shine through us. As we just keep our eyes closed,